We have a couple of command line utilities called AFExport and also an AFImport that you'll find in the PIPC/AF directory. This is for handling exports and imports of the database en masse. And it works just about the same way as what you would see just using the PI System Explorer. There are a couple of differences, though. You'll notice there's some extra arguments that you can use, like exporting into a format that can then be imported as a library into a SQL Server database. That's some of the things that you might find that we're going to be asking you to do if you give us a call on tech support. So you may find some extra things in here that you won't normally find supported in the user interface. And those are things that, as I said, in some circumstances, we may ask you to run those. Now, let me go ahead and demonstrate what this looks like when we run this command line utility. I'll go into our environment here and start up a copy of the command line utility. Now, I just chose start and then run, and I'm going to type in cmd. That's going to start up this command line utility. I need to switch over to the right directory. The directory here is going to be under program files, PIPC. I can just do a change directory program files. Or if you want, you can just type with an asterisk there. And we want to go to the PIPC directory. And I'll change directory to AF. And now here are my executables. The one I'm interested in is this AF export and AF import. So let me show you the syntax we would use. I'll do an AF export in which I specify the default server name. Now, if I wanted to, I could put in the full name of the server using this backward slash as a delimiter, or I can just put in the period, and that indicates it's going to be the default server. So we're going to export, in this case, a database called OSIsoft Plant. Now, you will notice when you do this, as you choose the database name, we're only supporting in this utility the database names that don't have spaces in them. So that is a restriction you're going to have to look at. If you do need to export, you're going to have to rename your database to something without a space in it. That's a current restriction. I'm not sure if you're going to see that when you're using this, but that's a current restriction I'm under here. So I've renamed my database to OSIsoft Plant. And then if I don't choose any option to output, this is simply going to output to your terminal. So as you can see, scrolling across the screen there, that's the export. And let me go ahead and clear my screen. I'll show you that again. This time, except I'm going to add a slash file and then specify this is going to go to my current directory. I'll just call it myexport.xml. What that's doing is that's exporting, and it's giving me it's echoing what's going on as I do the export. And if we take a look at this, this is called myexport.xml. Yeah, here's my export. Now, once I've exported, of course, I can import back in. And I'll show you how to create that or how to do the import. When you import, you can actually create the database as you do the import if you want. But let me demonstrate a couple of the other options. One of the most useful options, I suppose, is this option in which you specify the name of a file that we're going to be reading information from instead of reading arguments from this command line. In the documentation, we call this a response file. And so you use this at symbol and then the name of a file. Now let me show you what it looks like here. I've got a sample response file. My response file is simply called myresponse.txt. But before we actually execute this, let me go ahead and take a look at that. Let's do a notepad myresponse.txt. What this is a simple text file that has some switches. So we're passing these switches one line at a time. Now here's a new one we didn't see before. That's setting this so that we export the default values. And you have to specify to turn that on. That will make this a much larger file because we're putting default values, even if they haven't changed. And in this case, I've also specified where my output file is going to go. I'm calling it my export. Let's call this myexport.xml. I'm going to distinguish that from my text files. And then I'm going to add the slash silent switch. So watch what happens when I use this myresponse.txt. Again, I'll just do a, this is going to be an AF export. What I'm going to be exporting is from the current database. It's called OSIsoft plant. And now, using this at symbol, I pass that myresponse.txt. A couple things happened. First of all, did you notice we didn't see the echo that we saw before? And that's because I put the slash silent switch that we didn't see before. And if we take a look at this, let's do a notepad, my export.xml. Yeah, what we're seeing now, we're going to see a lot larger file than what we saw before. Because now all those things that don't really have values that change from the default are going to be included. So let me demonstrate before and after. See, this is what I just did when where I specified default values. Let me exit out of that. Let me go back and just bring this back up. Yeah, see, if I had just done it like this, without those switches, and now we'll take a look at this again. If you notice now, we no longer see some of those default values in there. It's a much smaller file. Well, that's kind of a roundabout way of demonstrating that what we're doing here is we're passing this myExport.txt. And in this case, I used it to turn on the default values, which made my file a lot bigger. Okay, I'd like to go ahead and do the full round trip here. Let's generate a new file. And I'm going to specify some new arguments in this myResponse.txt. If you recall, myresponse.txt was just a simple flat ASCII file that we're using to specify where we're exporting to, and, well, actually just specifying all different types of arguments. So any of those arguments that you see in the documentation, you can specify here. I would like to specify that we do want the default values, and I'm going to get rid of this silent option here so that we do see the echoing of the results. Now, I make use of this by using, it's the at myresponse.txt. That's the argument I'm going to use. So I'll use that where it's appropriate. So I'll do an AF export. That's what we're going to be exporting as this in the current server. It's the database called OSIsoft plant. And now I'm going to pass that myresponse.txt. Now that should generate a new version of myExport.xml. Now currently, the current version does not have default values. It's about 30K in size. Watch what happens when I generate this new one. Yeah, there we're echoing. And now let me do a directory. Yeah, take a look at myExport.xml. It's about twice the size because now it's got those default values have been plugged in. So how do I make use of this now that I've created it? Well, what I'm going to do is use the AFImport, which, as you might guess, if we look at the arguments here with a slash question mark, it's the exact opposite of the AF export. It's going to allow us to create the object that we're interested in importing this into. Now, we specify a path. If the actual database that we specify in this path doesn't exist, we'll go ahead and create it at that time. So that's what I'm going to do in this case. I'll specify a brand new database called My New AFDB. Again, let's take a look at before and after. Make sure there's nothing been pre-planned here. Yeah, there is no My AFDB right here. I'm going to go ahead and create that by doing an import. So let's do this. It's going to be AF import. I'm going to be importing into the current database into a new database I'm going to be calling My New AFDB. So it's the current server and in a new database. And then the file is going to be, it was the one I just created called myExport.xml. There we go. It's processing this import. And if it looks good, I can go out here and switch over to that new database. There we go. It's called My New AFDB. And if we take a look at it, it's got all the same structure of what we just exported. There we go. Here's our mixing tanks, etc. And one last option I want to go over is you can do something called a save and load library from anywhere within the Pi System Explorer. What we're doing here is we're exporting to XML, but we're taking that XML file and we're actually storing it in the same SQL Server database that contains all your AF SQL structure. So we do that so that you now have a central repository for these XML files. When you do a save as library, it doesn't matter where your cursor is currently located. I can have my cursor anywhere. It's going to save the entire structure. So let me demonstrate. I'll choose File. Let's do Save as Library. I'll just leave the default. That's the library name. And now I can delete this database, for example, or create a new database and then import into that new database. I'll choose New Database. I'll just accept the default. This is called Database 37. I'll choose OK. And now if I load this library, you see we're listing all the libraries that exist that have been stored on that copy of SQL Server. And this is the one I just did. As you can see, it's bringing back the entire library, all the things about that library. You know, if we look at the library objects themselves, things like the enumeration sets, the templates, they're all there in that library. So that's a nice kind of a common mechanism for sharing these XML files across your organization because they're stored on the central SQL Server database that you all have access to through AF.